Hello, today we have an interesting presentation, important one as well. This was the keynote presentation of the virtual conference SPIN, Sharing Progress in Neonatology. This is 13th Bengt Robertson Memorial Lecture. The dignitary was Professor S. Abman from Denver, USA. He is talking about pulmonary hypertension, the hidden danger for newborns. The threat of pulmonary hypertension has been recognized and the root causes of it and the ways to tackle it and novel therapeutic approaches in this nanotechnology world. That is the presentation. The keynote speaker on this occasion was the respectable dignitary, Professor S. Abman from Denver, USA. I am presenting excerpts of this conference, and this is part three of this four-part series from this online virtual conference, Sharing Progress in Neonatology, hosted from Europe between June 10 to June 12th. And I am Dr. Karthikeyan Gangimuthu, consultant neonatology in Dubai, MD/DM and FRCPCH, and having consultant license in London. Let's proceed now. This is about pulmonary hypertension of the newborn. And to know the magnitude of this problem, this pulmonary hypertension in the newborn, on many occasions with etiologies as described, continues into the pediatric age group. This is a danger. It's a hidden danger, which gives you opportunities for treatment earlier on. But either if you miss the opportunity of right treatment or even otherwise, it gets prolonged and you see quite a significant portion of the pediatric pulmonary hypertension cases are imbibed from neonates and infancy. It's a wonderful picture here. What suggests it says pulmonary hypertension in the newborn. Three classical presentations. One is the most appreciated one, that is the meconium aspiration syndrome and persistent pulmonary hypertension. You see here, this is the slide from clockwise from the left. This is a meconium aspiration syndrome baby. It looks smaller, but this is severe persistent pulmonary hypertension in a term newborn, which commonly happens with are associated with the meconium aspiration syndrome. What we see in the picture, this is the powerful oscillator, sensamedics. Now, moving on to the right, clockwise. This is, you can see the baby is obliquely edematous, eyelids are puffy. This is a preterm baby with pulmonary hypertension. Many etiologies can be there. And it's a smiling baby, means the baby has grown out of NAC, but still baby has got a pulmonary hypertension that is associated with chronic lung disease or bronchopulmonary dysplasia. Somewhere the baby is receiving oxygen, or baby is in those one of those days where baby is having off oxygen timings. But baby has got pulmonary hypertension, it's probably on some medicines for correcting it. And there can be, as you are sure, chronic lung disease can have crisis, which one of the crises is hypertensive crisis, not pulmonary hypertensive crisis, right? So now, professor was telling about the magnitude of this problem that is carried on from the neonates onto the infancy and pediatric. He has got pediatric pulmonary hypertension network registry. All the cases are reported and registered. On here, if you see the group 3, this is pulmonary hypertension from lung disease and hypoxia. Of this group is there are two almost equal halves of this pie chart. There are almost two equal halves. One is there is pulmonary arterial hypertension, which is primary, might be, and it is 43.3% of the case of all the cases. This is idiopathic pulmonary hypertension, which is due to some inherited or hereditary. Most common in females and like that. And here, this is the one which is carried on from neonates and infancy. Bronchopulmonary dysplasia, chronic lung disease, 46% of this group. Congenital diaphragmatic hernia, equally warming pot, 36% of this group. Others contribute 18%, mostly congenital malformations like alveolar hypoplasia and those sorts of inherited disorders. Now, small percentage of veno-occlusive disease, 0.8%. And there is a primary pulmonary hypertension of newborn, 3.3%. And this was the group, 4.2% only now, the yellow one, which was a quite significant portion of this pie chart, might be 3 decades before. This is the left heart shunt lesions, asymptomatic lesions going for reversal and pulmonary hypertension, the Eastern Mega syndrome. Currently, this has come to a very low percentage of the overall pie chart. It is only 4.2%. 3 decades before, this would have been at least 50%, and there would have been practically no survivors of this home oxygen and all were not that much evolved 3 decades before. This is a new concept. As you more and more preterm survive, many babies go home on oxygen. So there, then their associated morbidities will be there. So it doesn't mean that medicine has regressed or has not progressed. It means that medicine has progressed to such an extent that we are able to salvage more and more extreme premature babies. Those can be discharged safely home on oxygen and they grow up to childhood. They have these morbidities. One of them is pulmonary hypertension, which needs treatment. Clear now? Let's move to the next slide. So this is the Pediatric Pulmonary Hypertension Network Registry, the paper which is in press by the dignitary of the keynote presentation of this conference, Professor Abman from Denver, USA. Next. Study this slide for some time. Here, there are early signs of pulmonary vascular disease that are associated with the increased risk of bronchopulmonary dysplasia and late pulmonary hypertension. What you mean is, now you know, focus, ultrasound, point of care, ultrasound assisted neonatal care, current thing, because you so know, when you see a baby with the respiratory distress of any cause, it's not like a pediatric patient who is having pneumonia and so on things. In neonates, it is cardiac and the respiratory parts are always interlinked. So we use a bandobast term, you can say, or a combined combo term, cardiorespiratory distress. Many a times, a baby with distress may not be distressed due to respiratory etiology, may require cardiovascular hemodynamic interventions like PDA, closer or medications, hemodynamic or vasopressor support, medicines to reduce the pulmonary hypertension. And so it's a combined management of cardiovascular and the respiratory system that will lead to the best outcomes. So this point of care ultrasound bedside in NICU gives you an objective evidence of how to manage these babies. And it's done many times because once you diagnose your problem, you treat it. The assessment of response is also by the same method by which you diagnosed. Correct? So it's a sort of indispensable tool in the hands of neonatologists now. Point of care ultrasound, focus. Right, so what they found was the identification or quantification of pulmonary hypertension with shunting, without shunting is getting more objective, more accurate these days. Septal flattening, the intraventricular septum, which is to be mobile, if it is not moving, left ventricle normally should have the high pressure, and with the contraction systole, what should happen, intraventricular septum should go to the right side. Septal flattening means there is a significant right side pressure after load is pulmonary hypertension. This is a significant sign. When there is septal flattening on day 7 of life as a marker of pulmonary hypertension, this is associated with an increased risk of BPD and late pulmonary hypertension. So adjusted relative risk, I'll just close it. Adjusted relative risk for late pulmonary hypertension is, see, risk is for isometric dilatation on day 7 more than threefold. Risk is more than threefold. And if there is septal flooding in days on life, the risk of late pulmonary hypertension is more than 2 times, almost 3 times. BPD risk is increased it's increased, but not to the extent of having that pulmonary hypertension at 36 weeks post menstrual age. This is the current definition for all these chronic events from neonatology at 36 weeks post menstrual age. We will so early signs of pulmonary vascular disease. So when you see that early signs, then why not you treat early? So that means you have to recognize that early. So this recognition has been found in 2015, reported in 2015. So once you see that trend, then you should be able to intervene effectively so that this is prevented. That's the logic. Now, so why this early hypertension should come? If you put that way, so less than 7 weeks, there's a hypertension is happening, means people hypothesized that antenatal vascular origins of bronchopulmonary dysplasia. You are what your mother grows you in her body, correct? You are what you are being grown in the womb of the mother, correct? So the mother's nutrition, overnutrition, toxins, stress, diabetes, obesity, undernutrition, high altitude, hypoxia, inflammation, cortisol, reduced uteroplacental flow, all will affect the placental function. Placenta is the one, is a sort of artificial life or the natural life for the baby, where the baby is inside the uterus. It supplies the nutrients, it gives oxygen. It has been found that it also donates methyl donors. Methyl donors, so understand this pathway, this methyl is folic acid pathway, is intrinsically related to all those genetic things and other programmings. So signaling molecules, programming of the fetus how to grow. These molecules are also the functions of placenta. Study this one. See the chart below. Maternal perturbation, any alteration, any of these events will be having a reciprocal or a response of the placenta, which can be detrimental to the fetal programming. The fetus is getting programmed by the placenta, and we are slowly identifying this pathway, signaling molecules and donors, methyl donors. All right. So antenatal vascular origins of BPD is the current new hypothesis which is turning into reality, to the extent that intervention is possible, therapeutic intervention I am meaning, in this nanotechnology world. So in 2017 it was published this paper, more details of it. There could be disruption of this angiogenic pathway by the way of decreased endothelial progenitor cells, decreased pro-angiogenetic factors, and increased anti-angiogenic factors. This is called angiogenic signaling. A entire field of angiocrinology, like endocrine angiocrinology, this is a newer topic in this nano world for neonates. Disruption of angiogenic signaling. So what angiogenic signaling in the pulmonary capillaries and pulmonary vasculature bed. So it is to decrease vascular and alveolar growth, reduce surface area and the vascular dysfunction, alveolar capillaries interface. It has to have a correct surface area. If the surface area is reduced, the area for gas exchange is reduced. Understand? So low to hypoxic respiratory failure. And so yes, impaired gas exchange, high pulmonary vascular resistance, and early and late pulmonary hypertension. And this in turn has a persistent effect or that will lead to late respiratory and cardiovascular disease, risk for pulmonary hypertension, pediatric pulmonary hypertension. So now, yeah, the next slide. So this slide, angiocrine factors. They are two derived from the endothelium. They sustain normal alveolar growth. Are you able to understand this slide first? I will try to explain you here. See on your left side. What is pictured? You see surfactant. You can see surfactant popping off. This is small one surfactant molecule popping off. This is one cell with a lot of lamellar bodies. Inclusions were contained. T-myelin and surfactant, pulmonary surfactant. This is the type 2 pneumocyte. Otherwise termed as 82 cell alveolar type 2 cell, type 2 pneumocyte. This one, the big one. Sort of macrophage-like function, which is in the surfactant synthesis. And it is the one which maintains the count of alveolar type 1 cell as well. So the type 1 cell is a flattened cell, squamous flattened cell, epithelial cell. This is a sort of supporting, but this major functional cell is the type 2 pneumocytes. The type 2 pneumocyte differentiates into type 1. So it's a type 2 which is the most important, and the two functionally for the most effect, for the most important function of the neonatal lung, that is secretion of surfactant, that is mature or nearing maturity around 34 weeks. Right, so people feel that endothelium is the one which is responds to many of the signaling molecules or even other events that leads to the production of endothelial growth factor, which in turn lead to insulin-like growth factor that sustains the septation and growth of the alveolar epithelium. So it is alveolar epithelium, and there is a capillary, which is that endothelial cell. Capillaries are lined by endothelial cells. So these are factors. Now people feel that it's not the pneumocytes that control, like this, it's interlinked in the angiocrine factor. Angiocrine factors derived from the endothelium or the pulmonary capillaries during the development, they play a major role in signaling development, maturation of the alveolar epithelium. Is this concept correct? It's not a chicken egg story. Which comes first? It's the angiocrine factor derived from the endothelial cells of the pulmonary capillary network. Look at this nice picture, having this type 2 pneumocyte surfactant bubbling out, alveolar type 2. So they found that in pre-eclampsia mothers, placental dysfunction is well noted. In those using as a study, if you study this graph from again clockwise from short segment upper left, this is insulin-like growth factor. This is reduced. Insulin-like growth factor is reduced in pre-eclamptic mothers. So insulin-like growth factor is epithelial growth factor also, and fibroblast growth factor induced and are related to each other. And so alveolar epithelium development is impaired. Vascular endothelial growth factor is a primary one. See this tight band. There is no dispersion like this. Why dispersion? Variability. It's a very tight band and it is low. Vascular endothelial growth factor is very low as compared to normal pregnancies in preeclamptic mothers. So once this is tight band, then this must be the primary event. So conceptually it was thought of. So growth factors, placental derived or maternal derived growth factors, vascular endothelial growth factor, insulin-like growth factor 1. This has been existence for many years. Insulin growth factor is the somatomedin derived and growth hormone associated. It's for somatic growth, all growths, including osteoblasts everywhere. Vascular endothelial growth factor is a new concept. It is called angiogenic growth factor, and it posts an important angiogenic signaling. So we see here there is an SFLT1 which is a toxic, not useful molecule, which is not useful factor, which is very much range, you see, it's slow in normal pregnancies, but preeclamptic phase is raised. And so here we see the VGF by SFT, which has to be, if it is more, it is good, because goodness is on the upper side, and SLFT, which is a detrimental factor, is on the numerator is a good thing, which is VGF, since it is reduced here, the ratio is tilted in favor of the detrimental factors SFLT1. So just remember the names: insulin like growth factor, vascular endothelial growth factor, and SLFT1. So, and this is a slide which at a higher level you should understand. So basically, a low fetal oxygen tension, you know, fetus is hypoxic, the oxygen tension in the fetus is around 30 to 40 millimeter of mercury. The saturation in the fetus is 50 to 60. So this is useful for the baby, because in that you get hypoxia inducible factor 1 alpha, and that releases vascular endothelial growth factor with a complex interaction between hypoxia as well. And there are certain molecules, experimental drug molecules, which can modulate this effect. Hypoxia inducible growth factor leading to vascular endothelial growth factor, which is released, and then it binds to the, this is all in the alveolar cell. Vascular endothelial growth factor is released, and then it goes into the endothelium, acts upon that. Vascular endothelial growth factor is generated there because of hypoxic response. Hypoxia is sensed in the airway as soon as the baby is. This happens with the transition most likely. And it is exaggerated by chorioamnionitis and preeclampsia. These are animal models where they inject ETX, endotoxin. ETX endotoxin. We inject endotoxin, you get a model which is mimics the chorioamnionitis. And preeclampsia is means the blood pressure should be high. It's mimicked by injecting this another one, is SFLT1. So once the vascular endothelial growth factor has to bind to your vascular receptor, that is vascular endothelial growth factor receptor number 2, and this releases nitric oxide, NO. That leads to proliferation and tube formation and angiogenesis. You know, this blood vessels budding, sequencing, making cylinders and tubes. They found that this has a very important role here. And then this also leads to the signaling process, leads to insulin-like growth factor, and then it leads to alveolarization. See, it's sort of circuit, it just comes like that. So these are interlinked. The prime signaling molecule in this is vascular endothelial growth factor, it's called angiocrinology, is the one which leads to the alveolar capillary differentiation or maturation. What are they saying? So this is angiogenesis, proliferation, tube formation, and this is pentose phosphate pathway. Pentose phosphate pathway is causes glycolysis, one of the pathways of glycolysis in ATP generation. This is used in the hypoxia. It's not at a state of normal oxygen tension, it's at a sort of at levels of oxygen tension which are not at the level of mitochondrial, it gets activated. Pentose phosphate pathway, and since inadequate glycolysis, this energy is level is not that much. So these are complex interactions. Yes, it's this PPP is pentose phosphate pathway. Insulin-like growth factor is signaled to be produced by vascular endothelial growth factor. So this is primary. Vascular endothelial growth factor is primary. And the effective molecule is nitric oxide, NO. That leads to angiogenesis. So this is in short, the try to simplify that. Know these molecules: hypoxia-induced factor, vascular endothelial growth factor, insulin-like growth factor, receptors, and there is pentose phosphate pathway. That provides the energy for all these signaling and equations. And that is where you get NADH and NADPH. I told you the methyl donors. Methyl donors are coming to play. Homocysteine and all these vitamins, complex pathway. We are deciphering it so that we are understanding the process of embryogenesis or fetal growth inside the mother's womb, including the organs. The most essential organ is the respiratory system, that's lung, parenchyma, the alveolar capillary interface, which is crucial for survival of the humans. So disruption of angiogenesis impairs the alveolarization in the developing lung. So they give some toxic like seizure control, where it's normal, but they give some toxins, angiogenesis is impaired, and you see the septation. See, this is almost emphysematous changes in the alveolar septa. Alveolar septa normally like this, many things, small lining. This is multiple alveoli burst, and then they form a common space like emphysematous space. But this toxin produces at least the surface epithelium is in continuity. But here, you use thalidomide, one of the potential toxins, ruptures. You can see discontinuity of the epithelium is more dangerous. This was published in 2000. Thalidomide, that one which causes short limb dwarfism and many other abnormalities, and used as a cough remedy, and now given and then given up because of invariably high increased risk of short limb loss. So the conclusions Professor mentioned was antenatal determinants contribute to the higher risk of BPD and its severity. Early and late pulmonary hypertension and late respiratory outcomes. Disruption of lung vascular development plays an important role in the pathogenesis of Brachyolmia dysplasia and also pulmonary hypertension. So early recognition of at-risk preterm infants, it does provide a unique window for applying preventive strategies in this nanotechnology world to improve the long-term cardiorespiratory functions. Is that clear? So it's sort of at day 7, if you find echographic evidence of right ventricular afterload increase, means pulmonary hypertension, it's significantly associated. The relative risk may be more than 3 times higher for development of persistent pulmonary hypertension later. The risk of chronic lung disease and BPD is also increased. These are the conclusion Professor made this keynote lecture. It is angiocrinology. Angiocrine growth factor, vascular endothelial growth factor, that is intimus, very intimately closely related to the insulin-like growth factor, hypoxia inducible factor, and also pentose phosphate pathway. This interplay is the one which results in effective alveolarization and alveolar capillary interface and appropriate function. So this is the keynote lecture on this pulmonary hypertension, the hidden danger of newborns. So these are current concepts of this century.